Alan came into the barn, and I said, Alan, that's the only thing I can really tell you is she shouldn't be doing this. And you need to be careful.
I said, you know, I even said to the owner then, she's not good for this. You know, she's not good for this.
I told Alan not to take Tyke on the road when he came to pick up that herd. I told him he should leave Tyke behind.
It was a beautiful day, and I wanted to see the famous circus.
I was 7 years old, and I was kind of excited because a circus never really comes to Hawaii.
And so we were all excited. You know, we just like couldn't wait for it to start.
When we went to the circus, my son told the usher that it was my birthday. So she specially ushered us to the front seat.
And we had really good seat. So we were like up front.
The next thing I remember is I'm crossing my finger that the elephant show will start.
It was either a high wire or a trapeze act before. And because I remember I was watching and it ended and there was some sort of announcement going on, or there was a fanfare or something, and there was a loud trumpet.
And Tyke was making noise. And she didn't come out. She was just shaking herself.
And I saw this beige form moving around on the ground behind the curtain. And then it came flying through the curtain, followed by the elephant.
And I was watching it. I watched the elephant pick him up, toss him back down, and roll him all the way out the curtain.
And I thought it was a dummy because it was very floppy. There was no angles to it, like elbows or knees or anything. It was all just very fluid.
And then when he came out is when we realized, oh my God, he's not playing with a dog. It's his trainee.
And there was a guy, he was in a blue sort of his outfit. It was his circus outfit. It was like a dark blue outfit, and he's going, stop, stop, stop.
And put his arms around the head of the elephant. And the elephant pushed him down.
And I saw the elephant go up, and that's when my daughter said, you know what, Mom, I think it's time for us to leave.
I remember the announcement, ladies and gentlemen, please remain in your seats. Everything is under control. And I thought to myself immediately, it clearly was not.
And then the elephant started running kind of like randomly around the arena. So it's okay, this is kind of getting out of control. What's going on?
And the elephant started coming towards us. And I mean, directly straight towards where we were sitting. And then we were standing already with our children in our arms. We went down the stairs and went out.
All of a sudden, a woman yelled, a woman and a man, get out, get out. And I was so confused, I didn't know what to do.
And I could hear somebody going, he's right behind us, he's right behind us.
next thing I know, we got hit down, knocked on the ground. And then I hear this big boom. And I look to the side and it was the elephant.
She looks at Elephant Tyke and she says, go away. She goes, you leave my grandma alone. Go away.
We came out and we're standing about here, holding our two children. And the elephant came bang through. I noticed the thing was bent out and the elephant was right there, going like. We took our children and ran this way, and I turned back and saw that the elephant had turned and went back.
If there's anyone that needs medical assistance, please let us know at this time.
There was blood all over the floor, and it still didn't, I think, hit me yet, like, what had really happened.
Mom, we need two ambulances here right away.
Okay.
Two people have been crushed, and I don't know
who else. Two people crushed?
Yes, crushed.
We got people who were trampled by elephants and people who are going to great shock.
Yeah, it kicked the trainer almost to death.
And then before I knew it, I was in the arena in a stretcher.
It started off as a day at the circus. Then before horrified spectators, an elephant went wild, trampling its trainers and escaping into the streets near the Blaisdell Arena. One person was killed. Police say 9 people were injured. At least 3 others were taken to local hospitals.
Its handler was 37-year-old Alan Campbell, who gave his life to save his young assistant.
The African elephant's owner is struggling to understand what caused it to suddenly become so agitated.
Police radios caught the frantic yells of Honolulu patrolmen as Tyke went on her tear through Kaka'ako.
Sergeant, want me to shoot that elephant?
Negative.
On the police scanner, we hear elephant on the loose in Kaka'ako heading toward Queen Street. And we all stopped and looked at each other and thinking, did we just hear elephant? So my photographer and I drove out this way and he dropped me off right here on the corner of Ward and Queen.
So I was just coming down Ward Avenue and turned onto the street. And when I got onto this street, I saw the elephant coming down the road here with the police officers behind.
I took my shoes off and I ran with my nylon stockings down that street looking for the elephant.
Came up to the corner and kind of looked, you know, what's going on? And I saw the elephant chasing a person around in the lot there and really, really agitated. And the person was just running around, all around the car, dancing around the car. The elephant was moving fast, the person was moving a little faster.
Watch out, Frosty! Run!
I remember glancing out my window and I see an elephant just going in circles around and around. I thought something's wrong. I see this gentleman try to close the wire gate on Tyke and she just knocks it open like it's nothing. And Tyke just goes after him. And it was clear that he was in danger. I saw a police officer raise his pistol and fires the first shot.
Those were the first shots fired. From there, she made her way through the streets of Kaka'ako.
And then I'm screaming, no!
Corner, we saw just an army of SWAT team members and police and fire trucks, and we were told to stay back. So we sat basically behind the police cars, and we saw Tyke right there sitting up. She was sitting up, and I just saw her trunk flailing back and forth because she was swatting away the barrage of bullets coming her way.
Yeah. We're told circus officials had tried to tranquilize the animal, but it just didn't work. And when the public safety became an issue, the police did what they had to do.
Okay, right now we have a live report from our reporter at the scene.
Dick, right now they're preparing to shoot the elephant again. They're behind us, behind the crowd. What they're trying to do is clear the area before they shoot the elephant. The elephant is down. When I got on the scene, he was chasing the owner of the pig review. Those are shots at the...
Come over here, girl.
People were praying. People were just silently sobbing. I heard, I think, a child's voice here and there. What's happening?
William Dallas Beckwith looked dead as the angry elephant Tyke tossed his lifeless body from side to side. But he's very much on his feet with only cuts and bruises, no broken bones, and no internal injuries.
The only one that really could get through to the elephant was already put down by the elephant. So no one else could ever get to that elephant. So there was no use in trying.
Beckwith has been working for the Hawthorne Corporation, the elephant's owner, for about a month. He was Campbell's assistant.
Tonight, the elephant's owner says the animal has never been a problem before, but made it go so out of control, kill its handler, and then trample people and property on city streets.
I have had elephants since 1954. This is 1994, and have never, ever once had an elephant go loose or go after somebody in a building or do anything in all those years.
Among today's claims that there were previous incidents with Tyke, and circus officials should have been aware of the potential dangers here.
In Minot, North Dakota, an elephant named Tyke belonging to the Hawthorne Group again got out of control and had to be contained. Prior to that, in Altoona, Pennsylvania, an elephant named Tyke broke loose from her chains, ran around the arena until she was controlled.
Animal Rights Hawaii wants the court and city officials to ban animal performances in the future.
First encounter with Tyke, walked into the barn. Mr. Cuneo was showing me the herd, and she turned, ears out, picked up a mouthful of hay or a trunk full of hay and threw it at me. And I said, uh-oh. Oh, Mr. Cuneo downplayed it. Oh, Tyke, she does that with everyone. She's just getting to know you. She just... And I looked at that elephant, and I said, uh-oh.
This is me with Tyke and Jackie in Japan in 89. And she was pretty fair size back then. I'm 5'8". I said right there, she had been over 7 feet tall. She knew her tricks, and she did everything. You know, she was a pretty versatile elephant. She used to throw the balls and catch batons and ring the bell. And she used to ride a tricycle, which she got too big for. Yeah, she was a good little working elephant, you know.
Tyke was one of the performers So she would only be brought over to my side of the barn periodically. But when she was brought over, I couldn't even go in the room with my elephants because she'd charge me. She'd have her ears out. She was an unhappy camper. You know, when she was over there, I just didn't go in. I threw hay from the other side. but she had quite an attitude.
And this is the last memento of Tyke. This is a piece from her tusk, and I took this from her to, let's say, equal the playing field, because I noticed she was trying to use it on me, and as I would walk by her, she was a little bit more, she only had one, and it was on her left side. She was a little bit more apt to rub me a little bit more with this tusk. This tusk hit me before her skin, before I felt her skin touching me, and she knew it. And she'd put a little bit more pressure to push with this tusk. So I said, okay, well, we have to equal the playing field. Once I took that from her, she became a better elephant for me. I moved to Venice because of the connection with the circus. I spent 30 years or so involved with Ringling Brothers. This was their winter home. You know, we'd spend 10 months out on tour and then come down to here for 3 months and then start it all over again. I mean, I can't go anywhere without remembering something that went on back when I was 18, 19 years old. I've been coming here since I was, a kid. I'm constantly walking in, memories. My mother asked me to take my siblings to the circus. The circus was in town. I knew nothing about circus, really, and what goes on. So I took them to the show, and that was my first time. So the last act to come on was the elephant act, and that's what did it. That's what did it. It was the elephant act, the music was jamming, and the elephants were moving, and seeing Gunther Gable Williams, it was just one big party out there, and I wanted to be a part of it. It was the magic of Gunther Gable Williams. It was just something about him that made me say, I want to work with those animals because of this gentleman, the way he handled the animals. I wanted to be a part of his crew. And I ran away with the circus that night. But to the moment I joined the circus, I've always been nigger this and nigger that. Black man don't work here. Black man will never be. One day I was 18 years old and I stood up and I said, I just sick of all the negative. And I said, I'm gonna be the first black animal trainer around here. Well, fast forward 15 years, I was the boss's right-hand man. I was working with all the animals that he was working with. My first job was with Hawthorne Corporation. I was a trainer for them. I was in charge of trucking them around, their safety, their welfare, their, food, anything and everything about the herd was all on me.
Tyrone Taylor is living his dream, performing and traveling from city to city with his herd of elephants. He's one of only 100 elephant trainers in the country.
Intelligence is important, and the desire. I love this work. This is not work to me. This is playing.
Mr. Cuneo's elephants were known as bad elephants, and bad meaning disposition. He had some tough elephants, and you had to be really firm with them to get around them. We had Tyke, Jackie, Hattie, and Queen. Tyke and Jackie were the African, and Queen and Hattie were my two Asians. Tyke was temperamental. I enjoyed working with her. She was very, at the point I had taken over with her, she was, I'd say, very, very gun-shy, very, very touchy. She was instantly expecting some type of discipline. And I saw that in her. I saw that, and I was reading it. I had to read this elephant. I had to rediscover everything about this elephant because no one told me anything about her.
I was the compound manager, and I was also in charge of taking care of the breeding bull that they had. When the acts were in, they all were lined up and chained in the barn. And other than getting practice, they stayed chained up 22 hours a day. Not being able to wander around and visit and interact and do all the tactile stuff that elephants do so much of in their daily lives with each other. They just weren't able to be elephants at all. They were the little pets on a string that people wanted them to be. I was one of the very few women that were working elephants at that time. It was testosterone fueled. It was guys being tough, being macho. I can beat up a full-grown elephant. I can bring a full-grown elephant to their knees. It was just more the culture back then. They would be beaten until the elephants were screaming, until they gave up whatever behavior they were doing or not doing.
Becky! Becky! Come on, baby. Wear that foot off. Sit in that foot. Touch. Perfect.
Tyke, she required a lot of more discipline because she was strong-willed and she just fought tooth and nail to not have to do what she was doing. And so she required a lot more work, tuning up is what they used to call it, than some of the others. Just a lot of discipline, heavy-handed discipline, a lot of spankings. It was ugly.
Things have happened in her lifetime, and she has kept those thoughts. I mean, she's a very smart elephant, and she kept all that with her. And being as large as she is, if she was afraid of something or something wasn't going her way, she would actually just leave. She would step out. That's what I mean, stepping off. Then she would leave.
An African elephant named Tyke went wild before a circus performance. The elephant burst through the doors of the Jaffa Mosque where the circus was performing, causing about $12,000 in damage.
Altoona, Pennsylvania. Okay, we get there, and another trainer had came in and to see if I had needed any help. He was in the same organization. We were both from the Hawthorne Corporation. And his groom, the trainer's groom, was really agitating my elephant that day. Well, she wasn't having any of it, and she decided to go run around and run through doors. The police were called out. I believe they were going to shoot her. They wanted me to step away from her. They were telling me to step away, and they had firearms out. There was no way for her to get back in the building. She's on a two-story overhang. What are we going to do? Well, my job is not to leave my animal. I was not going to leave my animal. I was going to get her back to where she needed to be. And we did all right. So we got her back to the barn and taken care of and put her away, and everything was good. No one was hurt, but she did run. She did cause a spectacle, and she did run. And that's when she was known. Then I knew she was a runner.
The first time I heard of Tyke was in 1993. Someone from the Humane Society in Altoona, Pennsylvania called us, said an elephant had crashed out of an indoor arena
knocked out some doors, wound up out on a loading dock, and it took him a couple of hours to get her under control. Luckily, it was a loading dock, and she couldn't step off. If it had been a street out there, she would have been gone. It would have happened in Altoona instead of Hawaii. And the person from the Humane Society asked me what they should do. And of course, I said, don't ever let her perform again. If she's an African, she did that once, she's gonna do it again. Africans just don't put up with what Asians put up with for so long. That's what people don't know about elephants. They're just dangerous. And you have a false sense of security somehow in a performing situation. I mean, I know probably as much as anybody about how they act and what they do. And they'll always surprise you, and something that you don't expect could easily happen at any time.
After Altoona, I said, you know, I even said to the owner then, she's not good for this. You know, she's not good for this. This is just my personal opinion from what I see, and also from my history, from the knowledge. I mean, I've worked Africans. I've been taught how to do all this from a great trainer. So now I was expressing that I don't think that she's good for this, but I was being dismissed as I don't know what I'm talking about. You know, you just need to be firmer, you need to be heavier, you know, you need to get her back in there, you know, and this is how you do it. And over at Hawthorne, they had a reputation for heavy-handed training. A lot of the trainers were, I'd say, old-school trainers. They've been around. They've come through the ranks because they've had their families. You know, in this business, it's passed down generation to generation.
I'm born in the business, fourth generation. My parents weren't with animals. My dad was in concessions. My mom was an aerialist. I knew in third grade I wanted to work elephants. I wanted to make my life.
Here they come, the biggest performers of them all, the Walker Brothers Circus, performing elephants.
I was taught how to use a bullhook, you know. Most gentlemen, you cue with your right hand. You carry the bullhook in your left hand. You're cueing them by voice. If there's a problem, the elephant's getting lazy, you know. Instead of skipping, it's gonna, I feel like doing this today, you know. Then maybe you'll take the bullhook and shift it to your right hand. And then they see you moving the bullhook, you know. Not just me, you could take certain trainers that I grew up with could go into Tyke and work her the same way I did. There's just a certain discipline that you've got and a certain way you work elephants, you know. And then you have certain trainers that came in that, like I said, I didn't know Alan. I didn't know this Tyrone. I didn't know any of these guys. You know, I grew up with a certain era of trainers. And then these guys came along, you know.
When I'm affectionate with my animal, with my elephant, it's all hands-on. It's all love. It's all here. It's under the leg. It's behind the ear. It's showing them all this love that they're gonna get, because they get that from each other through their touches. So I have to be more hands-on and physical, and not just light touches. I'm giving hands-on, I'm letting them know you're elephant, I'm elephant. Oh, it's good, good, even through my tone of voice, it's good. A lot of my work is done from over here. I don't have to come across unless I really need to catch an ear. You know, remember, that's elephant, that's 10 foot tall. How am I gonna get her head down? Put her top head down. You bring head down. If I have this and I just want to move and I don't want to bring the hook out, then I can say move, 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 move back, move back. Come in line, come in line. Voice changes. Come in line. All right, come in line. Trunk, trunk. All right, move up tail. And then we move out. So everything has changed because now we become elephant. We step hard. Because elephants, even though they step light, they're stepping hard.
Elephants are big and they can be very dangerous. And the theory back then was, well, as long as they are afraid of you, they're not going to do anything. I was told that you had to use a hook, you had to be tough with them, you had to beat them up if they showed any kind of reluctance to do what you wanted. But if you happen to have an elephant that was strong-willed and spirited, they were the ones that were going to give you trouble because they thought about it. And they looked at you and went, you know, you're full of it. I don't have to do what you say. I'm 10,000 pounds. You're not. That little stick is not going to help you any. And elephants are methodical. Asian elephants will wait for years to kill you if they are so inclined. They hold a grudge. They have long memories. African elephants, too. I mean, they're very bright, they're very intelligent, and they will remember you forever, whether it's good or bad. And you better hope that they're thinking good thoughts if you're having to go in with them again.
I went through several grooms that Mr. Cuneo gave me, but I knew I needed only one. My groom was Warren Wilkinson, and he's a gentleman that I've known since he was like nine years old.
I told you I ain't changed, bro.
Look at you.
I told you I ain't changed. How you been?
Oh, man.
Yeah, it's been a long time. I trust Tyrone with my life. I've known him my whole life. At Hawthorne. First thing he did was he brought me over, let me see the elephants, explained to me a little bit about them. Kind of gave me, you know, the rundown that they were different than the animals I was used to working with. That they were a lot more aggressive.
This was like the raw days right here. This was my first act. Oh my God.
Dude, this is crazy. That's like this.
I'm constantly yelling, Tyke. Even if I'm working with the other elephants, I yell back, Tyke, Tyke, so that she knows that I'm constantly watching her. Right there, always doing
it. Yeah, she's hesitated a little bit.
Backing off.
Yeah.
Backing off. You gotta see it ahead of time. She doesn't get up like the others. She's always backing out. She doesn't move as fast as the others. And this is not because of physical ailment. It's because just her personality. She's a little defiant.
And stubborn. But you still gotta give her credit because she still did. You know, she might have hesitated, might have stepped out every now and then, but to me, she did a good job.
She's a smart elephant. She was a very, very good.
I love that trick with her.
That's why John Cuneo loved it. Yeah, she thought she was in trouble right there. She missed the baton. And then she shied away thinking she was in trouble.
Because 9 out of 10, she probably would have.
Probably would have been. She would have been in trouble for that. Someone would have gave her some reprimand for them throwing the baton wrong.
That's what I miss right there. I'm telling you, dude. I loved when she did that.
Now, in the past, and I really believe this from her past, she thought she was in for some type of big trouble once gotten back to the line because of everything that she was doing in the act, all these little things. And she's that smart. But
oh, yeah.
Yeah, remember that day? This is where she decides to go in her own direction and step out of the herd. And this is a potential danger right here. She knows what she's doing. She knew she had done things in the act, and she knew that she could face reprimand inside the picket line. in the back of my mind, it was a thought that she could potentially run, hurting someone. I, at any given point, could bolt out and do some damage. Yeah, I didn't feel it was necessary for her to be there because of the potential danger already that she was showing me, and I knew that something could happen. Minot, North Dakota, and it was an outside date. That means our ring was set up on the outside. We were at a fairground. Mr. Cuneo had sent out another groom for me. He says, you need another groom. And I said, I had my groom Warren now, and I didn't need another groom. He was persistent on working with Tyke, and no one works with Tyke but me, and I don't need anyone messing with Tyke or doing anything, getting her attention. And this gentleman proceeded to keep calling her name. And I told the gentleman, don't say anything. Just stand there. Don't say a word. But he was persistent on just calling her name, letting it be known, I know that elephant. I know it. I know how to handle Tyke. I know what to do with Tyke. Everyone that came from that organization thought they knew what to do with Tyke. It was the wrong thing to do. And that particular time, she waited until the right time and she went after the guy.
I just heard Ty calling Tyke's name. I turned around and that's when I seen Tyke attacking him, Mike Pursley.
She turned and knocked him into a portable dumpster. We had a portable trash container, huge container. And she pinned him up against that container and used her trunk to grind him into that container, and used her trunk to knock him down and go on him, used the base of the trunk, and had a trunk wrapped around one ankle and kept pulling him back.
She kicked him, would pull him back to her. Kick him, pull him back to her. She did that probably about 3 or 4 times.
She's trying to kill him, so I had to get her off. And what I did was I stuck my bullhook into her ear. And that's all I had. There was no way, there's no time to wail and flail.
And that's when she took off from Ty. And we were on a 20-minute chase through Minot State Fairground for her. Ty had Queenie. He yelled for me to grab a chain. I grabbed the chain out from underneath the truck, put it around my neck, and we took off running.
She was trapped between some buildings, you know, wreaking havoc. And I had to go in. No one but me.
He passed Queenie off to me. He started going toward the workshop.
And I just called her. Real stern, got her attention the same way I always have. No discipline and opened up. And I knew I had sacrificed myself. I had to just show her. No hook in hand. Hook was over here, but no hook in hand.
And she turned, ears flared out. I just started thinking bad. I'm like, now I'm gonna have to leave this elephant unattended if he needs help. To my surprise, she just walked right up to him.
She ran up to me like a big dog and just towered above me and let me give her all this love and hugs. And inside, I am scared. I'm just heart beating because she just tried to kill someone.
And to, I think, both our surprises, she didn't give us any problems. She literally walked back to the picket line and we chained them both up.
Once I got her back to the herd and got her chained down, I said, no, we're not gonna use her anymore. I'm just not gonna take her off these chains unless it's load her up and bring her back to the line because it's too dangerous. Thank God no one was hurt, but I mean, someone was hurt, Mike was, but no one in the park.
While it was going on, I don't really want to say it was scary because I really wasn't thinking of it like that. After it was all done and said, and me and Tyrone sat down, that's when it hit me. And I won't lie to you, that's when it hit me. And I, if I'm not mistaken, I even told Tyrone. I was like, dude, that freaked me out.
That was the last time in July. Yeah, 93 was the last time I used her in a performance. And I still had to go. My contract ran through September, October. But I wouldn't use her. I used just the three. And despite Mr. Cuneo and us battling, I just used the three. And I told him, Zell's gonna kill someone. I just felt like she should be in a sanctuary, zoo, or some type of establishment that's just gonna let her be an elephant.
Two days before I left Hawthorne, Alan came into the barn, and I was working in there with the elephants, and he was like, oh, if you work my Africans the way you work these, you'll be great. I said, Alan, I'm not gonna be here. He was like, what do you mean, you'll be here? I said, no, dude, I gotta go to Florida. I'm meeting up with Tyrone, we're doing Ringling. I'm not gonna be here. I'll see you in a couple weeks. So whatever, Alan. That's the only thing I can really tell you is she shouldn't be doing this. And you need to be careful. And his last words to me before he walked out the barn was, well, if she gets out of line, my Africans will get her back in line. I said, all right, I wish you the best, man. He said, all right, I'll see you in a couple weeks. I started laughing and I said, I'm not gonna be here. He's like, all right. And he walked out the barn. And the last I heard about Alan was when I seen it on the news.
I told Alan not to take Tyke on the road. When he came to pick up that herd, I told him he should leave Tyke behind. He laughed. Typical macho reaction. Oh no, I can handle it. I can get a handle on her. Because he had the option. She could have stayed. I could have put her in the bull barn and she would have been fine. But that wasn't an option, and the Hawthorne Corporation did not offer that as an option to Alan. It was all or nothing, because typically the bookings that the Hawthorne Corporation made were for an act of so many elephants. And if you didn't have that many elephants, that contract wasn't going to be upheld. So the number of elephants was paramount in the bookings.
And Tacuño, they were there to make him money. You know, and to me, money's not worth a life. There's no amount of money that can repay a life. So I think he should have been done, had her off the road doing that. Before me and Tyrone got to her, he should have had her, you know, away from that. But, you know, greed makes people do stupid things.
Alan wasn't ever the focus. Alan was the byproduct. He was the bycatch. He was collateral damage. She wanted to get rid of that groom. Alan was trying to stop her. She said, you know, this isn't your fight, but if you're going to insist on it, I'm going to make sure you get out of my way so I can finish doing what I was doing. And then she stands, she's looking, she's got her ears up. I'm sure she's listening to the other elephants that I'm sure are yelling in the background. Even if you can't hear it on tape, there's no doubt she's listening to the other elephants. And she's trying to decide what she's going to do, and then that guy moves, and it's just a hair that he moves. But it's enough to bring her attention back to him. She didn't have a plan. It's not like, well, I'm going to catch the bus, or I've got a waiting car for me that's going to speed me off and we're going to live on the lam in Mexico or anything. The natural flight response triggered in her. She knew she had to get out. She wanted to get away from it all. She wanted to get away from the noise. The huge amounts of adrenaline that were flowing everywhere by that time in the arena. She knew she was in really big trouble. And she knew she would have been chained up. She would have been beaten a lot. And she said, I'm going to get out of Dodge. And took off.
She was shot 87 times. She was shot all over her body, in her eyes. And I remember that huge head just leaning against the car.
It was heartbreaking to see such a majestic creature, such a beautiful, huge, gorgeous elephant lying in the street of Honolulu, lying on the street of Honolulu with that ridiculous pink party hat on.
Mm-hmm. My boss called me and he said, hey, we gotta go retrieve that elephant. I said, the elephant that was on the news? He said, yeah. I think they killed it. It's down in Kaka'ako area. I said, oh my goodness, they killed it. Why did they kill it? And he said, I don't know, but we just got the call. We have to go pick up the body. She was, there was a car here, just like how it is now, and she was lying down on her right side with her legs sticking out across the road here. I could see some blood off of her, and you know, I remember seeing like a tear stain coming from her eye, and I remember that, you know. That struck me as like, you know, like she was crying, you know. Why did they have to kill me, you know? So we had a front end loader come in here, scooped her legs up, slid the chain underneath, secured it, did the same for the back legs, and the operator in the crane tightened up on the rigging. Then I reversed my trailer back under her body, hanging up. And then we, the crane operator loaded her down on the deck. We had a little tarp, wasn't much, you know, just to kind of cover her face. We couldn't cover her whole body. And then we had a police escort, and we went up to the Halava industrial area where the quarantine station is located. And that's where we took her body.
Right near the spot where Tyke fell to her death. Animal rights groups had a memorial service for Tyke right where the female African elephant was shot down.
Supporters of Animal Rights Hawaii returned to the site where circus elephant Tyke was gunned down. The president of the group says the elephant is not to blame for the tragedy. She blames what she says is the inhumane treatment most circus animals receive.
They're shackled often 22 out of 24 hours, are routinely deprived of food and water, made to wear stupid costumes, and this is considered wholesome family fun.
In the days following her death, we worked very quickly and we scheduled demonstrations. We could see that this had really made a difference. So we decided that we would go forward and try to make sure that this could not happen again.
Animal rights groups nationwide are speaking out about the circus incident.
Acting Mayor Jeremy Harris today said he is thinking about banning any circuses featuring animal acts from city facilities.
The Tyke incident was an international incident. This was going to affect circuses worldwide. This was going to have an impact, we thought from the beginning, not only on the smaller city councils in the United States, but all across the world for that matter. Well, I worked private investigations for a number of years, and I drafted a proposal for Ringling Brothers to deal with the animal activist groups. And it started as something small and became a much larger issue.
For 10 years, Steve Kendall of Scott Township spied on animal rights groups for Ringling Brothers and other circuses.
I have a number of individuals that are directly inside animal rights groups. Some of them may be out there protesting.
You're talking about double agents?
I tried to make it look like I was friendly with some of them at some point, but at the same time, I was gathering the information.
They're not shackled all the time. No, they take them out of those.
They're still shackled right now. I bet you if we went over
before the show, for the public safety.
You want to take a walk with me down there? Talk? Just
okay.
Talk. Come
on. Sense. Because,
is that the camera going?
No, it's not going right now.
Well, good. I don't mind.
Let me do it to you sometime. Let me just shackle you for 23 hours out of the day. I'll let you walk around.
That's not, they say, that's misinformation.
Let me shackle
not 23
you.
Hours
How many
day.
Hours is it? Give me the hours, and I'll use that from now on. Give me the hours. How many hours a day are they shackled?
I can't give you a direct figure of how many hours, sir.
Then how do you know? Give me an
I
estimate.
I do know.
Give me an estimate.
They take them out every 4 hours.
I helped organize counter demonstrations against the animal rights activist groups. Initially, we did have to pay various individuals to come out because we needed to have groups of people that would at least be able to get the attention of the public to show that there were individuals that were supporting the circus.
They're animal rights activists. Just ignore them. Have a great time. Now you can take it, throw it right in the garbage where it belongs. Have a good time.
And I look at the animal rights groups as being at times a minority extremist group where their views are going to be totally against what the public wants, what the circus industry wants, and even for the most part, politicians. President with Ringling Brothers, and he said, Steve, we're going to need you to go over to Hawaii right away to deal with the fallout from this particular accident, and at the same time, too, deal immediately with the city council, considering the fact that the animal activist groups wanted to ban the use of animals in entertainment immediately after this incident happened.
So this building here is Honolulu Hale, and this is where the city council headquarters is. And it's the location of where we did a lot of the work with testifying in favor of the bills that we were trying to get passed at the time, that were geared at banning live exotic animals in performing shows, such as circuses and traveling shows.
Chairman Felix, members of the committee, the animals most commonly used in circuses and other traveling animal acts are wild and can behave instinctively and unpredictably. If they become out of control, they are further punished, up to and including death, as we experienced with Tyke.
Prior to this event, our animal-related position had been that we just said that animals that are used in entertainment, or whether they be domestic or wild animals that are used in entertainment, should be treated humanely. That was our position. And after the Tyke incident and relooking at our position statement, we really came to the conclusion that you couldn't treat a wild animal humanely in the entertainment business.
The circus industry will tell you that they are repositories of endangered species. USDA inspection records of John Cuneo's elephants show a dearth of even the most basic husbandry records. They will boast that their animals perform because they like to.
I remember them as if it were yesterday. Kathy Gogol, the ringleader, I'd say, of Animal Rights Hawaii, was a nasty individual. She was not someone you could talk with or reason with. She had a one-track mind, and that was to lash out against anybody that was opposed to their point of view.
It was outrageous. The industry, the circus industry, employs people to say that everything is wonderful, everything is great. The elephants love doing what they're doing. And it's like the emperor has no clothes.
These animals are all trained through positive reinforcement. There's a lot of misconceptions on how you get an animal to perform a certain act. When an elephant stands on its hind legs, this is something it does naturally in the wild. They reach branches off trees. They also stand on their hind legs when they're engaging in the act of sex. The facts remain that the animals don't do anything other than what they do in the wild, and this is incorporated into the acts.
And I argued the fact that the public had a right to choose whether or not that they wanted to see this type of entertainment. And the fact is that the circus had a history going back hundreds of years and has continued to gather families from across the nation that come out and support the circus and go to the shows.
Some would say the circus is an old tradition. It's part of American culture. Slavery, as well as child labor, was an American tradition. It was part of American culture, and it is now part of American history. And American history is where exotic animals and traveling shows needs to go.
You know, when videos or information was provided to the politicians and then it didn't seem to make a difference, or didn't seem to get a result, I don't know. That's confusing to me. I don't know why that didn't happen that way. You know, I don't know. I don't know why we didn't end up with a result that was more supportive of the bills.
Well, I would say that it involved a lot of money, and it's a business. And the argument that, well, it only happened one time, might have prevailed. But on the other hand, we've never had another elephant come into this community. So, bill or no bill, legislation or no legislation, the outcome was and has been that there has been no elephant coming back. We have not had live circuses with wild animals allowed here and has not come back. So ultimately, it did prevail.
Nicholas and Gypsy, the two last elephants that were at the Hawthorne Corporation's place in Illinois, the same place where Tyke came from.
Hey, if you guys want to take off, you can go ahead now.
This is Nicholas, the former circus elephant from Hawthorne Corporation.
Nick Target.
When we first started training Nicholas, he was, of all the elephants that I've been involved in converting from free to protected contact, he was probably the most afraid of the target when we presented it. He would turn and duck his head and squint his eyes like he was anticipating being hit. And I think that's indicative of the harsh training that he received before. And he had that level of fear of something on a stick.
That's a big, mighty foot.
You know, when he comes in, he knows nobody's ever gonna hit him here.
Are you thirsty?
I think he wants a warm drink.
If he doesn't want to come to the wall, and he doesn't want to work, and he doesn't want to present his foot or his ear or his trunk, or open his mouth, he doesn't have to. He can stay over there, or he can go back outside.
Nick, open. Nick, oh, where are you going? Come here. Nick, open. Can we see that tooth? Good boy. Let me see. There you go. Good boy, Nick. Good boy. All right, Nick. All right. Good boy.
Sometimes elephants come in, they don't know even that you can eat the grass, that's even an option. Because a lot of elephants in captivity have never been able to walk on grass. Behind me is Gypsy, and she was in the circus her whole life, like Tyke. And her life is different. You know, if she wants to go in the lake, she can go in the lake.
If she wants to scratch on a tree, she can scratch on a tree. If she wants to dig her own mud hole, she can dig her own mud hole and roll in it. Tyke could have been right next to her. I think in 50 years, we're going to look back and say, can you even believe that we used to keep elephants on chains and drag them in trailers and trucks and trains around the country to ostensibly teach children about elephants? It just is amazing to me that it's happening at this point in time, but in 50 years, in 10 years, hopefully it's not going to be around.
A lot has changed. The times have changed. Even, you know, circuses have changed. There's nothing going on much. A lot of it's just memories. This was actually a safe haven. There was never any animal rights activists here. And it was more like the city council and all the higher ups that really felt that it was too much to have the circus. This is the old circus winter quarters. We used to get the shows together, and so Ringling Brothers started from here and then went out on tour for 10 months and then came back at the end of the season. This is the arena, the big top, where the performances were inside here. This is where they were held. So all that's left of it, it's been stripped down, all the seats, the outside shell, everything taken off. I'm still grateful that the shell is still standing. But it's sad. I mean, we had a good time here. So every time I look at it, I do remember the good times that we had here. It was home. That's why I never went home again. I never went home again.
From the old school, so I feel that animals really, that's circus to me, you know. I mean, circus is animal. Liberty acts, cat acts, elephant acts. People love them. You see that. I look at the public, you know, when they're watching my show. You watch them when the animals come out, you know. They love the animals, you know. They love to see them. But these animal activists and these people like this are, they're not going to stop. And when they're done with us, you know, I'm sure they're going to start on pets. People want elephants. Well, we're going to make life just so miserable for them and hard that they can't, you know, so they just keep chipping away. They just keep chipping away. I want elephants, you know. I do shrine circuses now. If they had in their budget for elephants, I'd lease elephants in a heartbeat.
Once again, we would like to remind everybody that we're going to be here throughout the entire weekend. We do have one more circus performance today at 5:30. Tomorrow, we only have one performance at 3 p.m. So tell all your friends and neighbors to come on out and listen to the circus.
And Tyke, they had some kind of special connection. We used to walk in that barn in the morning, and he would walk up to that elephant and be like, Africa. She would lift her head up and rumble, and it was just watching it, I could see the connection.
I loved that elephant. There's something about her that I connected with. I liked the way she showed me her affection. She'd stand above me, and I'm 6'3", and this elephant's standing, and I'm looking up at the top of, underneath her chin when she stood above me, and she let me hug her on her neck and hug on her, and she just, she let me be around her. So that's what I love most about it. She let me be around her.
When I look back at it, if I could have changed my life and said elephants wouldn't be involved, it would be devastating. The time I spent with elephants was amazing. Just priceless. There's no other animal I've ever worked with that can compare with what I got with working with elephants and the relationship. There's nothing better than being hugged by an elephant. It's just the most wonderful, warm, when they take their trunk and blow against your face and they wrap their trunk around you. It's fabulous, wonderful. But those days are gone. If I could have worked elephants without all the brutality, oh, that would have been fabulous, absolutely fabulous. And when I look back, like I said, I'm sure there's a special place in hell for me for what I did to the elephants, because that was what I was told I had to do to stay alive and to keep those elephants in line. But now I know that was all nonsense.
I'm probably the most critical person of all of our place here, because I don't drive through here and think, oh, how nice it is that they're eating grass. I drive through and think, why are they behind a fence?
You know, our philosophy is that elephants are not designed for captivity at all. And you can do what you can for them, but you'll never match what they should have if they were in the wild.
Say, what do you think went wrong? What went wrong? Why did Tyke do such an unnatural thing? That's the first natural thing that Tyke did in her life, was to run. She did it in Altoona. She injured people in North Dakota. And finally in Hawaii, she acted like a real elephant and said, I'm not supposed to be here. I'm tired. Whatever excuse they gave, somebody made a noise, somebody walked behind her, it's always somebody honked a horn, they always have some excuse why elephants take off. But Tyke, on that final day of her life, exhibited real elephant behavior, and it didn't fit the streets of Hawaii.